காலேஜ்ல இருந்தா பேசுறீங்க? காலேஜ்ல இருந்தா சார்? காலேஜ்லாம் இருக்கா சார்?
ஆ இருக்கு பா.
பா
ரெகுலரா காலேஜ் போயிட்டு இருக்கீங்களா சார்?
இல்ல இல்ல 2 டேஸ்.
2 டேஸ் ஆ ஓகே சார். காலேஜ்ல அட்மிஷன் நடக்குதா சார்?
ஆ நடக்குமா.
ஓ ஓகே சார். எப்படி இருக்கீங்க சார்?
ஆ நல்லா இருக்கேன் பா. நீங்க எப்படி இருக்கீங்க?
நல்லா இருக்கேன்
சார். எத்தனை கிளாஸ்? செகண்ட் கிளாஸ் ஆ இது?
ஆமா சார்.
சூப்பரா
சார். எப்போ சார் காலேஜ் திறப்பீங்க?
திறந்து தானே. ஏனா
இல்ல சார் எங்களுக்கு
அதான் எப்போ லீவ் விடுங்க, எப்போ லீவ் விடுங்க கேட்டி இப்ப எப்பலாம் திறப்பீங்கன்னு கேக்குறது.
இல்ல சார் அவன் ஒருத்த மட்டும் தான் கேட்டான். சொல்லாதீங்க ஒருத்த மட்டும் தான்
கேக்கு. படிக்கிற பையனா அப்படிதான் இருப்பான். பிரணவ்
பண்றது
சார் காலேஜ்ல இருக்கீங்க?
ஆமாம்.
டேய் சிவாஜி என்ன நினைக்கிறாரு? ஐயோ
என்னடா அவரே எதுவும் கேக்கல. என்ன நீ சார் உங்களுக்கு எல்லாம் அப்ப போயிருக்கா எல்லாருக்குமே காலேஜ் ஸ்டாஃப்க்குலாம்?
சேடா சேடா கிளாஸ் ஸ்டார்ட் ஆக போகுதுடா. போதுடா
ரசிங்க பத்துறீங்களே அழி வாங்குறீங்களா?
இல்ல அவன்ட்டா சங்கர் வந்துட்டாரு. எங்க ரெக்வஸ்ட் நம்ம கொடுக்கணுமா? எதுவுமே சொல்லாம போயிட்டு
ரொம்ப மைல்டா இருக்கு சார்.
ஓகே ப்ரோ ஒன் செகண்ட்.
அதுல இருந்து போகுதா?
ஓகே பிரணவ் இப்போ கேக்குதா?
ஆ கேக்குது சார்.
ஓகே ஹாய் கைஸ் மத்தவங்க எல்லாருக்கும் கேக்குதா? Hi everyone.
What's up?
Can you hear my voice?
Yes sir.
Yes sir.
Yeah, okay. Okay. Hi students, I welcome you all for today's session on lighting techniques. I hope you guys know me. My name is Shankar. I'm a 15th professor in Department of Visual Communication FRM Ramapura. So today we are going to look at lighting, various lighting techniques used in photography as well as photography. So we will start the session now. Saranan sir, screen la theriyuda PPT? Hello. Okay. Okay, so when it comes to lighting, lighting plays a major role in visual content. As you guys know, you guys have practiced photography. So when it comes to photography and videography, the role of lighting is kind of similar. Lighting setups and techniques help us to create depth and mood to the image. More, in most scenario, it helps in providing visual characterization of the subject. And by creating a visual characterization for the subject, viewer get a clear idea on what the visual content or the subject is trying to convey to the audience. So it's the responsibility of the person behind the camera to convey the clear message to the audience. So when it comes to basic lighting techniques, we are gonna look into every key elements to advanced lighting setup. So today in the key elements, we are gonna check about the basic light sources. In light sources, there are two types of light sources, as you guys know. One is natural light and artificial light. So when it comes to natural light, you can take something like sun, moon, and moon, etc., or something like fireflies, everything. Whatever the light source which comes from nature, it will be considered as natural light. And the secondary thing will be artificial lights. In artificial lights, there are bulbs, LED lights, flashlights, and the things you we use in studios like strobes, everything comes under artificial light. So both the natural light and artificial light have its own characteristics. When it comes to natural light, we cannot control the natural light. It tend to change its color in various time of the day. For example, in morning, the light will be, like in the early morning, the light will be in orangish color. After it will be turning it to yellow. By noon, it will be clear white or something. By evening, it also changes. So we cannot control the light. It changes colors in the various part of the day. When it comes to artificial light, each light source has its own characteristics and color, like bulb, strobe, LED flash, and we can control artificial light. So that's the main difference between natural and artificial light. So the purpose is to understand the lighting. That's the when you are shooting indoor in a controlled environment like a proper studio, you can shoot in a same lighting setup as much as you need. You don't have to change the lighting continuously to adapt to the surrounding scenario because you are shooting it in a controlled environment. But when it comes to natural lighting, you have to have a proper understanding of light. If you fail to understand the light, the mood created by the natural light differs. For example, if you are starting to shoot in the morning, like you have to shoot a early morning scenario, you are planning to shoot in a golden hour, like morning 6 to 6:30 time, you are going to the beach and you are setting up the light camera and you are starting to shoot, the lighting, the nature of the light and color will be totally different. If you fail to shoot the condense in the limited time, after some time, like after 9 or after 10, the tendency of the light, the intensity of the light increases. So we may not get the desired result. So the basic thing is you have to understand the source of lighting, whether it's natural or artificial. The second thing is understanding the light. When it comes to understanding the light, there are four properties of light. The first thing is quality. How good is the light? Okay, so when it comes to natural light, it has some desired quality. When it comes to artificial light, it has some quality. So we should be considering the quality of the light. When it comes to natural lighting, the quality depends upon the time of the day. So usually morning and the evening are the best time for practicing photography because the quality of the light will be so good. When it is on the noon, the quality of the light will be very harsh and it is not the best time for shooting. So similar ways, when it comes to indoor photography, the quality of the light matters. The quality of the light depends upon the equipment we use and the modifiers we use. The second thing is quantity. Quantity is the simplest one. The intensity of the light, how intense the light is going to be. We can control it manually. When it comes to shooting in natural light, we will be using some modifiers like diffuser or reflector to control the quantity of the light. When it comes to indoor photography, there are so many modifiers you can use variously. For example, a reflector, softbox, umbrella, reflective umbrellas. There are so many things. The third thing is color. Understanding the temperature we are going to shoot, that matters. For example, in indoor photography, we can use gel, those kind of things for setting a mood and setting up a color. When it comes to outdoor settings, nature has its definite characteristics of light, and we can modify it using the white balance settings in the camera. Most of the time, understanding the color definitely helps in creating a mood to the image. When it comes to blue being the coldest color and yellow being the warmest color, it tends to convey a message to the audience. As you see, if you take a picture in a warm tone, it conveys a different message. If you take a picture in a cold tone, it will convey a different message. Or else, if you are shooting some picture in RAW and if you are processing it in a different white balance settings, it will convey different messages. The fourth thing is direction. So, direction of the light. According to our need, we have to consider shooting in the available direction of the light. When it comes to natural light sources, we cannot control the direction. We have to adjust the subject, or we have to place ourselves in a certain position to adapt to the direction of the light. When it comes to indoor photography, direction of the light can be controlled totally, because you will be having enough equipments to adjust and modify the direction, lighting directions. So when it comes to nature of lighting, there are two types of nature. One is soft light and the other one is hard light. So what differentiates between soft light and hard light? Soft light, the transition between the, most of the time, images will be having, guys, can you see the screen? Hello?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir, we can, yes, sir.
Yeah, okay. So when it comes to soft light, every image will be having three tones in their facial. So the first thing will be the highlights. The second thing will be the mid-tone and the shadows. It will be common. Whenever we use a light, the primary things available will be the highlights and the shadows, and the intermediate portions will be known as mid-tones. So in this image, when it comes to soft light, the transition between the highlight to the shadow will be very smooth. Like the mid-tones will be very smooth and clear, so it will have a clear flow of image. Like the transition will be very good from the highlights to the shadows. But when it comes to hard light, the transition will be very abrupt. So the highlights will be there, the shadows will be there, and the midtones will be very harsh. The reason is the light source what we are going to use matters in creating a hard light and soft light. For example, if you are shooting in outdoors in natural light, if you place your subject directly under the sun, you will be getting hard light. So if you want a soft light, what will you do? You have to place them in some shady position, like under the tree or interior, or we will be considering some places whether the light doesn't directly hit the subject, but it gets reflected from some other sources and reaches the subject. When it comes to indoor photography, if you use a single light source without any modifiers, like without using a softbox or without using umbrellas to diffuse light, if you use a direct strobe into a subject or a direct continuous light to a subject, it will create hard light. If you diffuse the light to even it out to spread and reach the subject, it will create soft light. So these things, you have to understand the basics of the things. I will explain it to you quickly. The main thing is, first thing is light source, natural and artificial. You have to understand the lights and its four qualities. Then we will move on to the third thing, the highly and the most efficient lighting setup in the world. So it's common for both photography and videography. It's three-point lighting setup. So three-point lighting setup is widely used because of its nature of creating a three-dimension viewing experience to the audience. So most of the time when we use a single or two light sources, it will create a flat image. So instead of creating a flat image, it's a responsibility of the creator to convey or show a three-dimensional experience to the viewer. So we are going to look at it. Three-point lighting. The first thing is key lighting. The second one is fill light. And the third one is backlight. So when it comes to key light, a key light is the primary light source which will be used on the subject. Okay, so here as you see, there is a subject and there is a key light used. So it will be acting as a primary light source and the camera will be used on straight towards the subject. So when it comes to natural lighting, the key light will be the available light sources like sunlight. It will be acting as a key light. So when it comes to key light, it will be a single light source. It will create so much shadows and there won't be any detail in the background. So we will be adding another light source to the key light. So it will be known as fill light. So when there is a key light, it will create harsh shadows and the fill light will try to rectify or control the intensity created by the fill light. So most of the time, key light, if the reading of the key light is something around 500 or something, the fill light will be equally half or way lesser than it. So it won't remove the shadows full, but it will reduce the shadows to an extent. It helps to connect the audience in a real possible way. Like if you see some other human around us, it will already, they will be having shadows and highlights. So it will connect the audience in a certain way, in a three-dimensional way. The third thing is backlight. Backlight helps the subject and the background to an extent. For example, if there is fill light and key light and subject is placed before the background, there is a need to differentiate background from the subject. So backlight is used to differentiate the subject and the background. Backlight can be used in either ways. The first way is to use it as a rim light. A rim light is, as shown in the image, backlight can be directly kept facing the subject. So it will create a rim around their hair and the shoulder part. Or else it can be used as a proper backlight, in that the light will be turned to the background. So it will show the depth between the subject and the background. So the next thing we are going to see is the light modifiers. Controlling the light, each modifier helps in reaching a perfect situation or creating a perfect scenario for a photographer. So there are different modifiers available in the market. So the first thing is going to be the reflector. The thing is, when it comes to a single light source, a reflector helps to reflect the light and even it out to the subject. The second thing is grid. When you don't want to, like when the light is spreading and you don't want the light to spill around, like you just need the light to reach the subject, not to spill around, you can use reflector plus grid. And the third thing is snoot. Snoot is used for directional lighting. When you are using a light, you have to direct it to some certain person or the subject. You can use snoot, so it will direct the light towards the subject. And the fourth one is the commonly used softbox. You have seen it in various studios and all. The usage of softbox is, it will have a reflector and it will also have a diffuser. So by having a reflector plus diffuser, it will create a proper soft light. So when we, in the previous slide, we have seen the difference between hard light and soft light. So when it comes to the light used directly with the reflector, it will produce hard light. Similar ways along with grid also, it will provide for it produce hard light, and with snoot also it will produce hard light. But when it comes to softbox, it will have a proper white diffusion layer in front of the light. So it will diffuse the light and it will soften the light which is reaching the subject. And the fifth thing is reflector. Reflector is most of the time used as a fill component, like as a fill light for the light source. So when you use a primary key light with a modifier like a reflector, it will reach the subject, and a reflector can help reflecting the light and act as a fill light. So when it comes to reflecting the light, reflectors helps a lot. And when reflectors come with three variants, like normal white reflector, and there is a silver reflector and a gold reflector. So according to our nerd, we will be using the reflectors. The next commonly used diffuser is umbrella diffuser. It will be primarily used for videography, and it is also used in photography. It is also act as a role what softbox does. The difference is, in softbox there is a reflector, so it will control the light going to the subjects. But when it comes to umbrella, it doesn't have a reflector, so the spillage of light will be over. The next thing is, one sec, reflective umbrella is an other option for softbox. For a, it will have a silver coating inside, so it will amplify the light to an extent to give glow to the subject skin. So the next thing we are going to look is various portrait lighting techniques. So there are few portrait lighting techniques which are used by the photographers all around the world. These are the common photography lighting techniques used by most of the photographers around the world to achieve certain results. And it's, as I said before, lighting is common for both photography and videography. So the way we use the lighting for photography can be also used in videography, and it will be used to convey message to the audience. So when it comes to portrait lighting techniques, the need for understanding the portrait lighting technique matters. Most of the scenario, we will be having a subject in our frame. So most of the time, the subject can be a human subject. So understanding how the human face reacts to the light helps us to create a mood and depth to the image. So the first thing is Rembrandt lighting. So when it comes to Rembrandt lighting, it's a lighting technique used by a Dutch painter. He paints the most paintings in the Rembrandt lighting technique. So how Rembrandt lighting technique works? So there is the subject, the camera is straight before the subject, and we will place the light source. It may be any light source, 45 degree left to or right to the camera. So when we keep the camera 45 degrees left or right to the camera, and we have to adjust the height of the light source in a certain way to get a triangle in the adjacent opposite. When we keep the light on the left side, we have to see the triangle on the left side of the image. So under the eyes, there will be a triangle created. It will be known as Rembrandt lighting. So the main thing and the thing you have to understand is, it is the easiest lighting module to create. You can create a normal, you can just keep a subject in the front and you can directly take pictures, but it won't have the depth. When you want to have a depth to a picture, and it, this is the easiest technique to follow. That's not Rembrandt lighting. So if you practice it with a hard light source, it will be easier for you to understand it. Like you can get into a closed room or a dark room, and if you adjust the lighting, you can easily get the triangle below the eyes, and it will be known as Rembrandt lighting. The second thing is split lighting. in the split lighting, the thing is, the camera will be directly before the subject and the light source will be 90 degrees left or right to the camera. So when it comes to 90 degree, the light can be kept in the left or in the right, and if you take photographs, the light will reach only one side of the subject and the other side will be left blown out. So the thing is, the light reaching one side and the other side will be it doesn't have any light reach, so it will be known as split lighting. And the third portrait lighting is short lighting. So here we are keeping the subject face directly the camera. Here we are asking the subject to turn a little right and we are setting up the light over there. So when the light here, when we look into the human face, this is the short side and this is the broader side. So we will be lighting to the shorter side of their face and it will be known as short lighting. And when we light to the broader side of the face, like here, it will be known as broad lighting. So the thing is, we will be making the subject to turn a little off to the camera and we will be setting up the light. And if you set the light to the short side, it will be known as short lighting, and if you set the light to the broader side, it will be known as broad lighting. The next thing is butterfly lighting, or it will also known as paramount lighting. So this is one of the famous lighting techniques used for beauty shots for female models mostly. The thing is, when we are creating a butterfly lighting technique, the thing is, we will be keeping the camera directly front to the subject and the light source above the camera. So when we keep the light source above the camera facing the subject, it will create a shadow below their nose. In a way, it look like a butterfly. You have to check the position. It will create a shadow, look like a butterfly. So this is the thing. It was used like in so many movies, so many advertising campaigns, everything for female beauty shots. Butterfly lighting is the widely used lighting technique. The next thing is flat lighting, the common lighting used everywhere. The thing is, there will be a key light and there will be a fill light, and the intensity of the both the light will be same. So it won't produce any shadows. In this type of lighting, everything will be fully light without shadows. And these kind of flat lighting techniques will be used in commercials, like commercial photography or in commercial advertisements. They tend to use flat lighting. The next thing is loop lighting. When it comes to the loop lighting, the similar way, the camera is placed directly in front to the subject and the light will be placed left or right 20 to 30 degree from the camera. So when we place the light in 20 to 30 degree right or left from the camera in a circular position, it will create a loop around the nose. So this will be known as loop lighting. So the thing is, these are few of the portrait lighting techniques. So if we understand, and practice this 7 portrait lighting techniques, you will be getting better at photography and as well as videography. So understanding the concept really matters, and after understanding it with and practicing it with a single light source, like a fill source, you can continue it with adding multiple light sources, like adding a fill light and as well as a backlight. So in the shown example, we have used a single light source of a key light, for the Rembrandt lighting, a full split lighting, short lighting, and for all like kind of lightings, we have used a single light source. But first, start practicing it with a single light source. Keep practicing it with a single light source and keep on adding other light sources like fill and backlight. So, once you add multiple light sources, it will create an appealing image to the audience. For example, this is the hard light one is a single light source image. And single light source Rembrandt image. Here, when it comes to soft light, there is a key light and they have also used another light source for filling the shadows to a certain extent. Like they have used the power of half of the key light. So there is still shadows, but the shadows are very smooth and it's not hard as of the hard light. So it's also a Rembrandt light with soft lighting technique. So using multiple light sources definitely help in having a different appeal to the audience. So when we are using lightings, there are few lighting techniques you have to avoid. The first thing is, I will say it an example. We shouldn't keep the light very closer to the subject in a higher or top angle. So it will create harsh shadows under their eyes. So it won't look flattering. The second thing is, you shouldn't keep the light source below the subject, and because it will create uneven shadows, and we are totally familiar with the light source coming from top or in the straight position. We are not familiar with the light source coming from the bottom towards the subject. So the shadows will be creating to the upper portion of the body and it will give a spooky image. So most of the time it will be used in horror films and those kind of time they will be trying different set of lighting like low point lighting and high point lighting and all. So the thing is, understanding and using the light definitely helps in creating the mood. And the one more thing is checkerboard lighting. So the difference is, here there is a key light, there is no fill light used, but there is a background light used. So checker light is the lighting technique which is used the lighting technique used here is known as the split lighting on the subject. So the split lighting, half the portion of the face is well lit and the other is not lit and properly. So it creates a half shadowed and half well exposed image. So when it comes to backdrop, in the side of the bright light subject, we will keep a dark backdrop, and in the dark side of the subject, we will be keeping the bright backdrop. So it will create a drama to the eye. So when you are shooting something related to video or something, it will create to set a mood to the overall ambience of the frame. Okay guys, that's all for today. If you have any doubts, you can ask me now. Or if you want to see any of the previous slides, just let me know. I will help you out. Hello.
Sir.
Solunga.
Sir, the portrait lighting la first sonningla Rembrandt lighting adu mari solunga.
Sir. Adha sir, Rembrandt lighting mattum oru vaati konja detail a.
Sure. So this is going to be the Rembrandt lighting. Rembrandt lighting எங்க ரொம்ப ஃபேமஸ் ஆச்சுன்னா, இட் வாஸ் யூஸ்ட் பை அ டச் பெயிண்டர். அவர் யூஸ் பண்ற மோஸ்ட் ஆஃப் த பெயிண்டிங்க்கு எல்லாத்துக்குமே அவர் சப்ஜெக்டுக்கு யூஸ் பண்ண லைட்டிங்கோட டெக்னிக் பேர் தான் Rembrandt lighting. அதுல இருந்து இது ரொம்ப ஹிட் ஆச்சு. த ஃபர்ஸ்ட் திங். த செகண்டரி திங் இஸ், நம்ம நார்மலி ஒரு லைட் கேமரால ஆன் கேமரா இல்ல ஆஃப் கேமரா, கேமராக்கு மேலேயே நம்ம லைட் வச்சு செட் பண்றப்போ இட் வில் கிரியேட் அ நார்மல் ஃபிளாட் இமேஜ். ஓகேவா? அப்போ அது இட் டசன்ட் கிரியேட் அ proper portrait or it won't create enough depth to the audience. அந்த மாதிரி இருக்கிற டைம்ல ஈஸியா கிரியேட் பண்ற லைட்டிங் டெக்னிக் என்னன்னு பாத்தீங்கன்னா இட்ஸ் will be known as Rembrandt lighting. அப்ப Rembrandt lighting எப்படி எடுப்பாங்க அப்படின்னா சப்ஜெக்ட் will be there. சப்ஜெக்டுக்கு ஃப்ரண்ட்ல கேமரா கரெக்டா லைக் ப்ராப்பர் ஆப்போசிட்ல கேமரா தே வில் பி பிளேசிங் இட். லைட் என்ன பண்ணுவாங்கன்னா லெஃப்ட் இல்ல ரைட்ல கேமரால இருந்து 45 டிகிரியில தே வில் பிளேஸ் த லைட். சப்ஜெக்டுக்கு கேமராக்கும் 45 டிகிரி ஆங்கிள்ல தே வில் பிளேஸ் த லைட். லைட் பண்ணிட்டு என்ன பண்ணுவாங்கன்னா தே வில் லிஃப்ட் த லைட் எபோவ் த ஐ லெவல். யூஸ்வலி நம்ம போட்டோகிராஃபி எடுக்கிறப்ப தெரிஞ்சிருக்கும் வி வில் பி யூசிங் லைட் சோர்ஸ் டைரக்ட் டு த ஐ லெவல். ஆனா இதுல என்ன பண்ணுவாங்கன்னா லைட் சோர்ஸ் கொஞ்சம் டாப்ல லிஃப்ட் பண்ணுவாங்க. லிஃப்ட் பண்றப்ப என்ன ஹெல்ப் பண்ணுவோம்னா டியூ டு த ஷேடோ கிரியேட்டட் எபோ த ஐ அஸ் வெல் அஸ் த நோஸ் இட் வில் கிரியேட் அ ட்ரையாங்கிள் பிலோ த ஐ அண்ட் எபோவ் த சீக். ஸோ இந்த சீக்குல அந்த ட்ரையாங்கிள் கிரியேட் பண்றதுக்கு பேர் தான் ரெம்பரண்ட் லைட். ஸோ இது ப்ராக்டிஸ் பண்ணணும்னா நம்ம சிங்கிள் லைட் சோர்ஸ் நார்மலாக என்னன்னா யாரையாவது ஒருத்தங்களா லைக் இஃப் யூ ஆர் இன் ஹோம் சிப்ளிங்ஸ் இல்லை பேர் யாராவது உட்கார வச்சுட்டு மொபைல் மொபைல் இருக்குல்ல மொபைல் உள்ள ஃப்ளாஷ் ஆன் பண்ணிட்டு லைட்ஸ் எல்லாமே டார்க் ரூம் ஆக்கிட்டு நீங்க இதை லைக் ஜஸ்ட் இந்த மொபைல் லைட்டிங்க லைக் சர்டன் பொசிஷன் லைக் 45 டிகிரி மூவ் பண்ணீங்கன்னா இட் வில் கிரியேட் அ ப்ராப்பர் ட்ரையாங்கிள் பிலோ த ஐ லெவல் அண்ட் எபோவ் த சீக். ஸோ திஸ் இஸ் நோன் அஸ் ரெம்பரண்ட் லைட்டிங். கைஸ் கிளாரிஃபை ஆச்சா? டவுட் இருக்கா?
ஆ எஸ் சார் எஸ் சார் எஸ் சார்.
வேற ஏதாச்சும் டவுட் இருக்கா?
இல்ல சார் எனக்கு ரெம்பரண்ட் ரைட்டிங் தான் சார் தெரியல அதான் சார்.
ஓகே ஓகே. சோ என்ன விஷயம்னா இது இப்போ சிங்கிள் லைட் சோர்ஸ் யூஸ் பண்ணிருக்கோம் எதுக்குன்னா டு அண்டர்ஸ்டாண்டிங் த லைட்டிங் கான்செப்ட் பெட்டர். நீங்க ஒரு லைட் யூஸ் பண்ணி அது பிராக்டிஸ் பண்ணிட்டீங்கன்னா யூ கேன் ஆட் மல்டிபிள் லைட்ஸ். இப்போ எந்த அட்வான்ஸ்ட் லெவல் லைட்டிங்னு போனாலும் த பேசிக்ஸ் வில் பி 3-point லைட்டிங். அதுக்கப்புறம் வென் இட் கம்ஸ் டு போர்ட்ரைட் ஒரு சப்ஜெக்ட் நம்ம ஃப்ரேமுக்குள்ள வராங்க அப்படின்னா இந்த 7 லைட்டிங் டெக்னிக்ஸ் தான் ஃபர்ஸ்ட்ல இருந்து இப்போ வரைக்கும் யூஸ் பண்ணிட்டு இருக்காங்க. ஆனால் த திங் இஸ் நம்ம அது அண்டர்ஸ்டாண்ட் பண்ணதுக்கு அப்புறம் லைக் ஹவு தே யூஸ் த லைட்டிங். இப்போ ரெம்பரண்ட் லைட்டிங்னா சிம்பிள் நம்ம கேமரா சப்ஜெக்டுக்கு நேராக இருக்கணும் லைட் ஒரு 45 டிகிரி ஆங்கிள் ரைட் ஆர் லெஃப்ட்ல இருக்கணும் ஐ லெவல்ல இருந்து கொஞ்சம் லைட் சோர்ஸ் மேலே சப்ஜெக்டை ஃபேஸ் பண்ணியிருக்கணும். அப்போ அந்த நோஸ் அண்ட் ஐயோட ஷேடோஸ் cheek level rappa it will create a triangle over the cheek. So idu da Rembrandt lighting. Similar way over lighting techniques ku over properties irukku. Appo nama multiple light sources for example or idellame nama or key light use panni edutha photo. Ippo nama inda pakkam shadow side la or fill light use panna ivlo harsh a irukadu. Adukapram back light one use panna hair oda details illa shoulder oda details theriyum illa பேக்ரவுண்டுக்கு ஒரு லைட் நம்ம யூஸ் பண்றப்போ சப்ஜெக்டையும் பேக்ரவுண்டையும் இது ஸ்ப்ளிட் பண்ணி காமிக்கும். சோ இட் will be definitely help. சோ நீங்க இது இவ்வளவு பிராக்டீஸ் பண்ணாலும் you will get a better idea about light. गाइस வேற ஏதாவது டவுட்ஸ் இருக்கா யாருக்காச்சும்?
இல்ல சார் அதான்
இல்ல சார்.
ஓகே गाइस சோ thank you for joining. Hope you had a great time. We will end the session now.